you very much for Dr. Abdullah Al-Khawali. And our next presenter is Dr. Samira Al-Habashni. She is assistant professor at the Maternal Health Department in Jamaat Amal Al-Ahliya. She has her PhD from Jordan University. Welcome, Dr. Samira. Her presentation, let me see the title of her presentation, The Impact of a Health Educational Program in Menopausal Knowledge of Self-Management Practices.
مساء الخير. في البداية بشكر بصراحة الدكتورة وسيلة والجمعية الأردنية للأبحاث طبعاً على الفرصة أن أشارك فيديو The Findings of My Study. I will not go with the slides really. I will present my study as story with menopausal ladies. My study, it was intervention study. And among the really our Jordanian menopausal women at Abu Nusayr, Amman, Abu Nusayr Center. And you know, our responsibility for us as women, as leader in nursing, and our account, we are accountable to let the women pass through menopause in normal and to improve their quality of life and pass it through this phase peacefully. And this is really what was in my mind based on the literature about life expectancy, increased life expectancy of women. They live now 10 to 15 years after post-menopause, and the other reason, the stop using of hormonal replacement therapy. You know, it is until now debatable to use or not to use for the side effects, evidenced by research findings, and changes in the lifestyle, in human lifestyle, also evident by research that this is will improve their quality of life. So I thought about our ladies here in Jordan, if we provide them with accurate information about menopause, what they can benefit from such program. The study really consists of two phases. The first study, or two studies we can say. The first study, cross-sectional descriptive study for 300, among 300 women, and to assess the severity of menopausal symptoms by using the metric scale. And it is similar to the findings in the world and here in Jordan, also supported by the previous studies about the percentage of severe and moderate or mild. And we can, from the study, every woman, she must pass through menopause with one or two symptoms, menopausal symptoms. And after that, I did the second study, which is the intervention study, by using a program. This program designed by me, and of course evaluated and validated by expert about the menopause, what the concept of menopause, and the physiological, psychological, and changes, social changes during menopause, and of course about the pre-menopause, preparation for menopause, and post-menopausal period. And this program took for 5 sessions, around 10 hours face-to-face with the women. I chose the women who have severe menopausal symptoms. Why? This is what you are, at least, they will commit to sessions. Because if they have, our women here in Jordan, if they are in need for or seek to help, they will come and to ask for help in the session. And what really we did, we sat together as a group discussion, and I discussed with them the concept of menopause. And really, they exchange their experiences with other ladies. And the focus of the program was on the health behavior, exercise, and mainly walking exercise. And about the nutrition, we discussed nutrition, the types of foods they can help them to increase their estrogen, and about herbal. Also, we discussed how to approach their life, how to value their life positively, and how we can improve their emotional well-being and social support through their plan for their life, and not to be loaded with other things and forget themselves. And the program really pre and post test, pre-test before for control, and experimental group or intervention group, you can say 30 women for intervention group and 30 women for control group. We did pre-test and then program for 5 session and waiting for 6 weeks. After that, we I did the post test and really it was this. Yes. There is a great influence of the program about the change. You know, the change, the knowledge to add knowledge in this age, it is really, even if it is really minimal, but it is considered a great influence because they used to do many things as a routine. But to add new knowledge for them to understand what's going on during menopause and how they can improve their quality of life by using the alternative measures. Next, please. This is the program. This is the education program, and the questionnaire was about self-directed behavior, positively and active engagement in life, emotional well-being, self-monitoring and insight, constructive attitudes and approaches, skills and techniques acquisition, and this is how to deal with hot flashes, how to deal with the night sweats, how to deal with anxiety, worries, and social, of course, integration and support, and health service navigation, and this is the role of the physician and nurses. Next, and if you can see, this is the intervention and the control group, and really there is and change. There is really a change in their attitude in all items. The change. Okay, next. The question is what we can get from this type of studies or such studies for our practice. We can educate our students really to understand the concept of menopause, and they can practice it in the clinical setting. You know, we go to a community service and we go to a maternity, and we can meet. The women everywhere, so we can collaborate or coordinate with the NGO or governmental institution to teach our women about menopause, and also we can consider recommend as this is a part job. This is, it should be a basic part of physician and nurses job because they are really with the women every day in the clinics or in the centers, and also the program really, the result showed that there was evidence of a significant change in the woman knowledge in the intervention group compared to the control group. Also, the study findings revealed that women who participated in a 5-week health educational reported higher scores of knowledge than others. Also, this is clearly support the importance of health education program among our ladies. We can, just for the application in Jordan here, we can, what I'm thinking to do really, like a website, and we will put soft copy, like a website, if they have questions, they can ask questions and we can answer them. Because from the session, we discussed together, they have many things to tell us really. They have many things to tell us about their experiences, about their sexual relationship, and you know, our ladies, they shame to ask these questions. So if we let them to express their feeling, and we can, and really, I face that, they side talk, they ask me many things about how to improve the sexual relation with their partners. And so we can teach them in MCH centers, we can teach them as in the women clubs, and some of them, they ask for a follow-up. They want like a center to let them to understand or what are the alternative measures they can do to relieve these symptoms. Yes, relieving symptoms very complicated. Replication of the study and self-management package, I said, we can use it and prepare it. Okay, next. Menopause. And really, as I said, it was a nice experience with the ladies. And we talked together, we sat together, we discussed many things, and at least if they approach their life and about their performance in their life, and they view themselves that they...
And his presentation title is the effect of cardiac educational program on knowledge and adherence to healthy lifestyle among patients with coronary artery disease in northern Jordan.
السلام عليكم. بداية بحب أشكر الدكتورة وسيلة على إتاحتها الفرصة لنا نعطي هاي البرزنتيشن. وثانيا بحب أشكر مشرفي في رسالة الدكتوراه الدكتور مؤيد أحمد سابق الدكتور كان مشرف علي في الرسالة. وبحب أثني على وشكر آخر للدكتورة وسيلة على أنها كانت أحد أعضاء الكوميتي في الدسكشن للثيسس. Cardiovascular disease in Jordan are the leading cause of death, responsible for about 33% of total death in 2011. Modification of coronary artery disease risk factors and adherence to healthy lifestyle are important factors in decreasing the progression of the disease. Therefore, patients should have adequate health information and education regarding coronary artery disease and risk factors. Okay. As a significance, all the general educational program in Jordan improve health-related knowledge that promote individual capacity to understand the health information. There were a scarcity in the studies that address the health education program in Jordan, as well as the studies that conducting regarding this issue. Thus, the purpose of this study was to test the effect of the cardiac education program on the level of knowledge and adherence to the lifestyle in Jordan. Okay. As a problem, disease knowledge contribute to patient accurate understanding of their disease and promote adherence to healthy lifestyle. Consequently, having adequate knowledge about disease may help slow down the disease process. While on the other hand, insufficient understanding of the disease may lead to emotional distress, maladaptation of the disease, and non-adherence to healthy lifestyle and unpreventable disease progression. As a method, I used a one group pre-test, post-test design, and the post-test was conducted twice at 1 week and at 1 month after the program application. A convenient sampling technique was used to recruit the participant in the study, and using a G-Power 2007 was used to calculate the sample size with the use of power 0.80 and the alpha size 0.5 and the effect size of 0.3, which is a medium effect size. Total 82 participants were recruited, and expected attrition rate because of the post-test was calculated to be 25% to have 102 patients in the final sample size. Next slide. Regarding the questionnaire or the data collected, demographic questionnaire, age, gender, monthly income, and education, and I used two tools to collect information regarding knowledge and adherence, coronary heart disease awareness analogy questionnaire to measure knowledge about coronary heart disease. The Cronbach alpha was reported in the previous studies to be ranged from 69 to 0.86, it was a 20 items scale regarding the pathophysiology, regarding the risk factors, regarding the treatment and the symptoms. The Cronbach alpha for the internal consistency in the study was reported to be 0.85, indicating that the all items measuring what's supposed to measure or measuring the same concept, which is the knowledge. Okay, next. The adherence scale, which is 11 items, and the Cronbach alpha in the previous study reported to be 0.73, and in the current study reported to be about 0.74, indicated that all items measuring the same concept, which is adherence. And okay, next slide. The adherence regarding the healthy lifestyle, regarding the dietary modification, smoking habit, physical activity, reduction in weight, stress management, reduction in lipid, blood glucose, and blood pressure levels. Okay. Translation and back translation were made, and no major discrepancy between the original and the translated one. The phase validity was conducted, and the content validity index also was performed, and indicated that the measure or the tool was valid. And in addition, a pilot study was conducted, about 15 participants, who possessed the same characteristics of the actual sample, and not included in the final sample size, okay? A structured interview was used to collect the information from the participant. in addition to the self-administered questionnaire, or in addition to the questionnaire, I made a structured interview to allow for the comparability of the result, and we can conclude that the outcome variables, which is the knowledge and the adherence, could be related to the effect of the education program, not for the interview, or not for the data, or not for the tool administered, or in the way in which the tool was administered. The total sample was 102. The educational program conducted for 92. The post-test conducted at 1 week, the total sample was 88, and at 1 month was 84. Thus, we have an attrition, but we meet the statistical criteria for the total sample size, and we want only 82, and the final sample size was 84. Next, please. Regarding the educational program, an active partnership program was applied, which is an American Heart Association program adopted in 2004. Okay, next. Regarding the content of the educational program, addressed the same content in the tool, which were about the symptoms, the causes, the pathophysiology, the risk factors, and the management, the weight management. And this program was implemented and in one university hospital in northern Jordan, and the participants were encouraged to include their relatives. Okay, next. IRB confirmed and approved the study, and written informed consent was obtained from all participants. Next. Regarding the next slide, regarding the participant, the mean age was approximately 53, where 47 males and 37 females participated in the study, and approximately were the participants were almost approximately equally distributed in the four educational categories, and most of them were in bachelor degree. Okay, next. Regarding the main result of the study, I calculated here the mean change, not a pretest or post-test, the mean change. The mean change at 1 week regarding knowledge and knowledge subscale for pathophysiology risk factors were significant both at 1 week and at 1 month after the program application. Same for adherence, was significant at 1 week, at 1 month after the program application, and were not significant for both symptoms and treatment. And the level of knowledge at 1 month was more than that at 1 week after the program and application. Okay. There are many factors could use to explain the result. The use of the combination of oral information, the booklet, could improve the knowledge. The standardized educational program, which was appropriate for the participant in terms of age, gender, Jordanian culture, and socioeconomic factors, help improve the knowledge. Next. Regarding the effect on the knowledge subscales, which were the effect on pathophysiology and risk factors. Next, please. It was significant. One possible reason to have a significant effect on pathophysiology and risk factor that the participant desire to master the disease demand placed upon them, to know how to avoid the disease. By knowing well about the pathophysiology and the risk factor, I can avoid further or future complications. Regarding the effect on the adherence, as reported in the literature, if the knowledge improved, the adherence may improve, and is supported by different studies. Next, please. Regarding the limitation, using of convenient sample, the short follow-up period for the adherence, it's better to measure their adherence 6 months, 12 months, moreover, and the use of self-administered or the questionnaire. We have to have a more physiological parameters to measure the adherence, like blood pressure measurement, weight, and the use of one group. I use one group because it was a preliminary study, first conducted in Jordan, such study, and in the future we recommend to conduct experimental studies randomized, which is the recommendation. Regarding the recommendation, next slide, deserve to be replicated using larger, more heterogeneous sample in different settings, and using longitudinal research to measure adherence, using randomized clinical trials. Regarding the conclusion, the last slide, the findings confirm the importance of the cardiac education program in improving knowledge and adherence to healthy lifestyle, and thank you for listening.
Thank you, Dr. Tawadi.
الله يعافيك.
في سيارة مرسيدس مرة شبيكة كانوا فاتحين فيها أبواب، صاحبها هي سكرة
الجامعة الهاشمية.
نفتح باب النقاش، نحب اللي بريزنترز يجوا هون، تفضل عند البريزنترز حتى start the questions, please. Before specify your presenter, then ask your question. Okay? Any question?
Okay. Thank you. Dr. Mahmoud Shahid from Jamaat al-Isra. I would like to ask Dr. Samira, as you know, don't you think that it's the right of all women in Jordan, whether educated or not, whether living in major cities or remote areas, to have this education program, especially that it's a major phenomenon for all women. Don't you think that we have to get in our recommendations for something practical to recommend this program to be for the media, mass media in Jordan, or something better than providing a website for, which is not useful in...
Not for all websites, yes. Yes. I agree with you. One of the question about the source of knowledge through the questionnaire, and the rich resource was the TV. So if you can arrange program in TV, this is when you can use the mass media to educate women about. And this is the right thing. This is the right, not in Oman, everywhere. But to arrange for that, you know, our recommendation, I put in my recommendation for my and I'm working now really with the, as I said, with the non-governmental organization to work on how we can benefit that from the program, teach them. I want to add something really, the opportunity given to ladies to express their feeling and experience, it was really nice. It was really great. They express feeling, it was like a therapy. We laugh together, we like fun, we let them express about their positive experience in their life, about raising children, about, these things, it was right, like a therapy, it's not, just not a program, no, it is a therapy for me. Thank you. Thank you for your question.
Dr. Hanker. Dr. Ayman Bani Salama, Al Zaytuna University. Actually, in my study, I used prevention of type 2 DM in adolescent Jordanian adolescents by changing their lifestyle. In my study, I concentrate on the modifiable risk factors, but about the non-modifiable risk factors or the genetic risk factors, there is a 50 gene phenotype. And it's responsible of increasing the type 2 DM in Aboriginal or indigenous people. Have you done any study about thrifty gene phenotype?
Well, we have, that's a very good question. We have studied a number of sort of gene-environment interaction projects. Asthma being one, but we've also studied obesity, which is obviously a very big environmental component, but where there have been well-established genes. And we've also studied type 2 diabetes, although it's not as common in the children, although there is still a growing population of type 2 diabetes in children in the U.S. because of the obesity problem. Now, I have also worked with Dr. Rana Danyi here at the university in Jordan on the Chestnut population, I'm not sure how you spell. There are two sort of isolated, relatively rare populations.
Yeah.
Cherkessian. So we have studied the type 2 diabetes genes. Now we are not very well powered because the numbers are not big, but we found still some very interesting genetic risk factors that others have shown to be involved, and one gene that sort of came up which was looked like specific for the population here. So there are clearly genetic factors in the population here in Jordan that are common among other communities that increase the risk of type 2 diabetes, but there may also be some specific factors that we have not seen elsewhere. But type 2 diabetes, I think the heritability is overestimated for type 2 diabetes because there is such a strong environmental component to type 2 diabetes that you can have much more effects on modifying those factors than you can in terms of modifying, you know, the proteins that these genes encode for.
Thank you.
Thank you. Also for Dr. Professor Halcon. I heard you in the other room. I followed you. I heard you talking about some drug or medicine originated by a Japanese company. Can you just briefly talk about it to this group, please?
Yes. So what we found was actually we found mutations in the neurotransmitter signaling pathway in the brain, which is called metabotrophic glutamate receptors, or mGluR receptors. And these receptors, they are activated by the amino acid glutamate. And glutamate is a key neurotransmitter in the brain, important for memory, learning, behavior, and various sort of cognitive traits and functions. And what we found is that a subset of patients who have ADHD, but also a subset of patients who have autism and who have schizophrenia, so all three diseases, they have patients who are missing one copy of one of the mGluR receptors. So therefore, they have only half of the protein for the signaling of the brain. And if you take an animal and you knock out one of the genes in mice, the mice become hyperactive and they become inattentive. So it's a very good supportive evidence from animal studies that this pathway is very important in attention and sort of the diseases that have to do with hyperactivity, neurocognitive deficits and attention. And as you know, there's a very significant overlap between ADHD and autism because about 35% of kids with autism have ADHD in addition. And then schizophrenia and autism become very, very difficult to differentiate between when the children with autism get older. So a child with autism is as likely to be diagnosed as schizophrenia. So it's very interesting now that there was this medication which is an agonist these mGluR receptor, and it's a derivative, so it's almost like a natural product of glutamate that Japanese had developed for dementia. Now they did not get efficacy in the dementia program, and when we look at the genetic findings in patients with Alzheimer's disease, they don't have any deletions in these receptors. So we could sort of have said in retrospect that, you know, it's not likely to work for dementia because there's no deletions of these glutamate receptors, but we see it in ADHD, autism, and schizophrenia. So now we are taking this, we got all the information about this medication from the Japanese. They had given this medication to more than 1,000 people. It was very well tolerated. There were no side effects because it's very natural. And it becomes now a very potentially important therapy to treat the patients who have one copy missing with this drug And we are going to start with ADHD because it's the most common disease and it's maybe easiest to measure. And then we're going to study autism and schizophrenia and hopefully demonstrate that you can reverse the consequences of these mutations by making the drug work twice as hard on the copy that is not missing and normalize the protein. So this is almost very similar to what I told you about the neuroblastoma, because we found that, you know, this ALK inhibitor drug works in neuroblastoma, but it also works in lung cancer and it works in lymphoma and colon cancer if the patients have mutations. So we are hoping that it doesn't matter whether you call it ADHD or autism or schizophrenia, if you have a mutation, you're going to respond to a drug which normalizes the consequences. So that's pretty much the key.
Thank you very much. Now you are invited. That was the last question, because you are now invited for lunch. It's in the central restaurant, which is to the south of the stadium. Thank you very much.